Mikhail Khodorkovsky was a Russian oligarch, owner of a Russian oil and gas company, and at one time, the richest man in Russia. But then he got on Putin's bad side while promoting reforms in Russia and spent a decade in prison for fraud and tax evasion, charges he says were politically motivated. He is now one of Putin's biggest critics and lives in exile in the UK. His new book is The Russia Conundrum: How the West Fell for Putin's Power Gambit and How to Fix It. Mikhail, welcome. So let me ask you first the question I think that is the most urgent and important, which is Putin's threat to use nuclear weapons. He said this is not a bluff. What do you think? Is Putin bluffing?
Putin is in a difficult situation now. If he loses in Ukraine, he is going to lose power and also possibly his life. And in this context, his readiness to use any method at his disposal is not a bluff. But at the same time, the very fact that he has declared mobilization, this means that in the nearest future he is not planning to use nuclear weapons, and it is unlikely that this is going to be posed on the agenda in a proper way before the beginning of next year.
But let me just be clear. You're saying that he's now going to try, as it were, to use mobilization and to use these new 300,000 Russian forces to attack the Ukrainians. But you do believe that if that doesn't work and if he is cornered, he could, in fact, use nuclear weapons?
I think that if mobilization does not yield the desired victory, the question of using tactical nuclear weapons is going to be on the agenda.
And when you think about this question, how are you thinking about what Putin's mindset is right now? You said he's worried about losing because if he loses in Ukraine, he would lose in Russia, and he might even lose his life. Explain to me how that would work.
When he declared mobilization, he made a very dangerous step. He has handed weapons into the arms of ordinary people, common people. Who are these ordinary people? When they arrive on the battlefield and find out what's happening there, they can easily turn their arms against the Kremlin itself. And this has already happened in Russian history before. 100 years ago it happened.
The last time you talked to him, you said he told you, you know, it's all right for you to keep doing what you're doing, but make sure your company does not in any way fund the political opposition. And you responded and said, well, the company won't, but I'm not going to promise that any individual will not. What I'm wondering is, tell us what what was he like at that time? Was he threatening? Was it like a mafia boss? Give us a sense of how Putin wields power.
In the Kremlin, during our conversation, it became clear that he had decided to rule the country as one would rule a gang. But at the time, he wasn't a bloody dictator. This happened in front of our eyes. In front of our eyes, step by step, from somebody who violated a sovereignty of a neighboring country in 2014 when he annexed Crimea, from that person, through the person who decided to attack a neighboring country, this evolution has happened from an autocrat through a dictator into a bloody murderer, a bloody assassin.
Do you think people like President Macron and Chancellor Scholz should be talking to Vladimir Putin at all?
I think that dialogue is necessary with anyone, even if it's a gangster who has taken hostages. Nevertheless, we have to realize that for any gangster, a dialogue with this gangster in a situation when the bandit or the gangster feels that he has the upper hand is demonstrating your weakness. And if you demonstrate your weakness over and over again trying to negotiate something with this gangster, this provokes this gangster to further attacks, to further steps, because they think that they're strong when they are in fact weak. And I think this is the problem of some Western leaders who are trying to negotiate with Putin and don't take it into account.
You say in your book that as long as Putin and his regime is ruling Russia, Russia should be treated like North Korea. But the question I have is, like North Korea in a way, many people have been waiting to see fissures or cracks in the ruling elite in Russia, or some sense that Putin is under pressure. And so far, it's been difficult to find. Do you think there are cracks in Putin's structure of power?
These cracks undoubtedly have appeared after the mobilization was declared. And these cracks are, in fact, are between those people who think that there should be no doubt about the war, and those people who understand that what is happening now is kicking them out, not just from a civilized community of people, politicians, but from life itself, expelling them, not just them, but their families as well. And this split, these cracks have already appeared.
So one way, of course, to deal with this issue is more assistance to Ukraine, help Ukraine do better and better on the battlefront. Are there other things that Western countries could do to help put the pressure on Vladimir Putin?
I think that at the moment, the most effective lever of pressure on Putin is victory on the battlefield. If the supplies of modern weapons allowed Ukraine to quickly move to the internationally recognized borders, this would remove the risks. But when we're talking about longer term, here the West has a serious lever of pressure, of influence. These are sanctions. And I think that sanctions linked to curbing prices on energy are quite odd. The decision that is being offered now on having a cap on Russian energy is something that doesn't work in the market economy. If our objective is to reduce the income that Russia is getting from selling energy, from supplying energy, one could introduce tariffs for Russian energy supplies that would actually remove the premium that Russia is getting today, because the European market for Russian energy supplies is a premium market. Of course, this would not impact short term, but in the medium term, it would have a really serious blow to the finance that Putin has at his disposal.
When I look at Russia under Putin, what strikes me is how personalized the power structure is. You know, when you think about the rules of succession, for example, you know, we know what happens in a monarchy. When the king dies, the crown prince becomes the king. If in a Politburo in China, for example, if the leader dies, the Politburo gets together and elects a new leader. What happens if Putin dies? It feels to me like nobody knows. Russia is run not by a set of institutions, but just by this one man.
Over the past 20 years of his rule, Putin has formed a totally criminal government. It is a regime he is holding under his control because he is pitching people against each other in his entourage. This already happened in the Soviet Union under Stalin. And after Stalin's death, his closest circle fell into conflicts, which lasted for 2 years, and then they crowned Khrushchev. So if nothing is being done, a similar scenario would emerge after the death of Vladimir Putin. Anyone who is going to aspire to become the next Putin would either have to face or put his faith in the power structures, including the security, various security services, or guarantee their entourage a better relationship with the West.